Hello everyone, today's lesson is about diarrheal disease in children. The term gastroenterite denotes infection of the gastrointestinal tract. The term diarrheal disease or diarrheal disorder is more commonly used to denote infectious diarrhea in a public health setting. And the term diarrhea comes from the Greek word which means to flow through. When we see definition of diarrhea, WHO defines diarrhea as passing three or more loose stool within 24 hours. And also we can use diarrhea as when the mother reports there is an increase in the fluidity, volume and the frequency of the stools of the child. Acute gastroenteritis is a diarrhea that lasts less than 14 days, whereas persistent diarrhea is a diarrhea that lasts for 14 days. And dysentery is a bloody diarrhea. So acute gastroenteritis and the persistent diarrhea is about the duration, whereas dysentery is about the composition of the diarrhea. Now, when we see epidemiology, diarrhea occurs approximately 3 times per year per child. And this diarrhea causes more than 700 million episodes of diarrhea annually in under 5 years of age in developing countries, and it leads to more than 80% of childhood deaths and around 1 to 1.8 million deaths per year occurs due to diarrhea, and 30% of deaths in developing world of under 5 is due to diarrhea disease. Rotavirus accounts for 35% of severe and fatal watery diarrhea episodes, and it is responsible for 500,000 deaths per year worldwide before vaccination. And early and repeated episodes of childhood diarrhea during periods of critical development associated with malnutrition, co-infection and anemia may have a long-term effect on linear growth as well as physical and cognitive function. When we see risk factors for diarrhea, we classify them into different groups. From this, the first group is behavioral risk factors such as inadequate breastfeeding, using feeding bottles, eating foods hours after cooking, contaminated food and water, not washing hands appropriately, and host factors such as malnutrition, measles, immunosuppression, young age, vitamin A deficiency and zinc deficiency. When we see the mechanism of transmission, the first mechanism is fecal-oral transmission. From this, for example, Shigella, E. coli, norovirus, rotavirus, Giardia, Cryptosporidium, and Entamoeba is transmitted through fecal-oral transmission, whereas cholera is transmitted by contamination of food and water supply. Salmonella, Shigella, and E. coli organisms are the most common pathogens in developing countries that is transmitted through foodborne. And the other is antibiotic-associated diarrhea, which is due to Clostridium difficile or pseudomembranous colitis. And the most cases of antibiotic associated diarrhea in children are not due to Clostridium difficile. Normally, water absorption in the intestine is 99%. From this, 93% is in the small intestine and the rest is in the large bowel. So, pathologies in the small intestine will have large volume loose than large bowel. When we see the mechanism of absorption, there is neutral sodium chloride absorption. This is due to, for example, cation exchanges. This exchanges sodium for hydrogen, whereas anion exchanges for chloride or bicarb. And absorption throughout small intestine predominates in this case, and it controls intracellular. The second mechanism of sodium reabsorption is through the electrogenic sodium absorption, which is by sodium potassium ATPase. And this is found in both small and the large intestine, but predominates in the colon. Whereas the third mechanism, sodium co-transport. In this case, absorption coupled with organic substance like glucose, amino acids, and the peptides occur, and functionally only in the small intestine. And this is not affected during acute gastroenteritis, and that is the basis for ORS or oral radiation solution treatment in diarrhea. When we see pathophysiology of diarrhea, diarrhea can be subdivided based upon pathophysiology. Can be osmotic, secretory, motility, and inflammatory. So diarrhea can be subdivided into 4 based on pathophysiology. When we see each of them separately, when is osmotic diarrhea first? This occurs when an absorbable solute such as lactose is not absorbed properly, and the mechanism is due to damage to intestinal epithelial cells. And etiology that causes osmotic diarrhea group, rotavirus, this selectively invades mature enterocytes and Shigella produces a Shiga toxin, which can cause villous cell destruction leading to malabsorption. This results in increased solute in the gut lumen and it causes fluid retention in the intestinal lumen and diarrhea. The second mechanism is secretory diarrhea, and this occurs when there is active secretion of water into the gut lumen. And from this, for example, infectious causes such as cholera and viral enterotoxins such as rotavirus. And the rotavirus produces the non-structural glycoprotein, which causes calcium-dependent transepithelial chloride secretion from the crypt cells with a resultant secretory diarrhea. And the other is from preformed toxin can cause secretory diarrhea. For example, Clostridium perfringens, Clostridium difficile, Shiga-like toxin, and the like can cause preformed toxins that cause secretory diarrhea. The other is non-infectious causes such as congenital problems, such as congenital chloride diarrhea, bile acids, fat acids, and the laxatives, and the vasoactive intestinal peptide, and the gastrin. When we compare osmotic diarrhea from secretory diarrhea, osmotic diarrhea causes less loss of volume compared to that of secretory diarrhea. Secretory diarrhea causes a large loss of fluids, and osmotic diarrhea stops when the child stops feeding, whereas secretory diarrhea doesn't stop despite fasting. And stool pH is less than 5 in osmotic diarrhea and it's greater than 6 in secretory diarrhea. And most of the time, reducing substance is more positive in osmotic diarrhea. And stool sodium is high in secretory diarrhea. The mechanism is motility. This is an uncommon cause of acute diarrhea. And there are two types of motility, hypomotility and hypermotility. Hypomotility causes stasis, and stasis predisposes for inflammation, and the bacterial overgrowth, and this causes secondary bile acid deconjugation and malabsorption. And hypermotility causes, for example, irritable colon of infancy, causes decreased transit time and it causes malabsorption. The fourth and the final mechanism of diarrhea is inflammation. The most common cause of inflammatory diarrhea is infection, and the ingestion of the offending organism causes colonization of the epithelium and the adherence to the enterocytes. And this causes mucosal invasion or production of an enterotoxin. Intestinal inflammation can also be caused by chronic disease such as inflammatory bowel disease and celiac disease. And most of the time, inflammatory diarrhea causes diarrhea. When we see pathogenesis of infectious diarrhea, ingested organism causes either intestinal colonization and cellular adherence, and it can either cause mucosal invasion or toxin production. If it causes mucosal invasion, it causes villous cell destruction. Villous cell destruction causes impaired sodium absorption and causes diarrhea. Whereas if it causes toxin production, it causes to stimulate chloride secretion and that causes diarrhea. When we see associated clinical manifestation of diarrhea, fever may occur, it may suggest inflammatory process and also occurs as a result of dehydration. And the vomiting suggests organism that infects the upper intestine. And abdominal pain and tenesmus can occur. When we get a child who is having diarrhea, we should have to assess by asking history, such as for how long does the diarrhea happen, and is there bleeding in the stool, and also assessing for signs of dehydration. And we should have to look at the child's general condition, and is the child lethargic or unconscious or restless and irritable. This is to just classify the severity of the dehydration. And also we should have to look for sunken eyes, and we should have to offer the child fluid, and is the child not able to drink or drink poorly, or is the child drinking eagerly or thirsty. And we should have to pinch the skin of the abdomen and the acid go back very slowly or slowly. So just things are just to assess the duration, sign, and also presence of the stool. When we pinch the skin, mistakes in the taking a pinch skin is one, pinching either too close to the midline or too far laterally. The other is pinching the skin in a horizontal direction. We should have to pinch vertically and not pinching the skin long enough, and also releasing the skin so that the finger and the thumb remain in the closest position. And we should have to classify skin pinch. Normally it goes back immediately, and we say slow skin pinch when the fold is visible for less than 2 seconds, and very slow if the fold is visible for more than 2 seconds. And we classify dehydration from diarrhea into three: severe dehydration, some dehydration, then no dehydration, based on those criteria. We should have to have 2 out of 4 of those criteria. For example, severe dehydration will have 2 of those signs, such as unconscious or lethargy, sunken eyes, drink poorly or not at all, and very slowly, with very slow skin pinch. Whereas some dehydration is the presence of 2 of those signs, restlessness or irritability, sunken eyes, drinking eagerly, and slow skin pinch. And no dehydration is when there is none of the above signs. In addition to those things, we should have to check for any sunken fontanel, any reduced level of consciousness, any eye sunkening, and also tearlessness, and also capillary refill time, vital signs, any recent weight loss, oliguria, and other things. The other is types of dehydration. This can be classified into isotonic dehydration, hypertonic dehydration, and hypotonic dehydration. The most common types of dehydration is isotonic dehydration. In this case, both sodium and water is lost equally, and plasma osmolarity is normal, and the serum sodium is normal. And most of the time, this happens in diarrhea. Hypertonic and hypotonic dehydration is rare. For example, hypotonic dehydration may occur if we give a plain fluid for a dehydrated child. This causes hypotonic or low sodium, and hypertonic dehydration may occur in the case of diabetes insipidus. When we see a laboratory investigation for a child having diarrhea, CBC can be done, and also stool specimen, stool microscope should be done, and also sometimes a patient is septic, bleed culture and the stool culture can be taken. Specifically, stool culture is done when stool is bloody, or if there is a WBC in the stool, and if the child is immunocompromised. And also serum electrolytes should be done to check the degree of derangement. The other is treatment of diarrhea. There are 4 principles in management of acute diarrhea. Those are replacing lost water and sweltus, continue to feed to prevent malnutrition, antibiotics and antiprozoal when needed, and the prevention of diarrhea without dehydration is treated as a treatment plan. In this case, fluid deficit is less than 5%, and this can be treated at home. And more fluid than usual to prevent dehydration, specifically ORS, should be given. And appropriate supply of food to prevent malnutrition, and we should have to counsel the family to bring back the baby if diarrhea doesn't get better or get worse. And fluids which are sweetened with sugar, which can cause osmotic diarrhea and hypernatremia, are not good during diarrhea. Those fluids include soft drinks, sweetened fruit drinks, and sweetened tea. And also fluids which are stimulants, diuretic or purgative effects, such as coffee, is not recommended. The second type of management is for some dehydration. If a child have some dehydration, from our assessment, we should have to treat according to plan B. In this case, fluid deficit is estimated to be from 5 to 10%, and we should have to give a child to drink ORS 75 ml per kg over 4 hours. And then we should have to reassess the degree of dehydration after 4 hours. And if there is no sign of dehydration, we should have to go to treatment plan A. We should have to give ORS and zinc at home. And if signs of some dehydration is still there, we repeat plan B. And if it becomes worse, we should have to treat as a severe diarrhea. ORS is effective in all types of diarrhea, and it can prevent dehydration if given early in the disease. And it is cheap, easy, and to administer, and it can be given by a mother at home. So no chance of overhydration or overdose is there on ORS. And the methods of administration include through the spoon, through the cup, through the syringe, or through the energy tube. There are different types of ORS, and the most commonly used is the WHO type. This have around 2 grams of glucose per ml, and 90 milliequivalent per liter of sodium, and 20 milliequivalent of potassium, and 80 milliequivalent of chloride per liter. The third type is treatment of severe dehydration from diarrhea. This is treated by treatment plan C. In this case, fluid deficit is thought to occur from 10 to 50%, and we should have to give IV fluid, specifically Ringer lactate, 30 ml per kg in the first hour, and 70 ml per kg in the 5 hour if the child is less than 1 year, and the child is greater than 1 year, 30 ml per kg in over half an hour, and 70 ml per kg over 2.5 hours. And we should have to reassess after the first hour, and if the child is slightly improving but not totally improved, we should have to give repeated 30 ml per kg, and we should have to reassess an infant after 6 hours and the child after 3 hours, and regrade the degree of dehydration and manage accordingly. Indication for IV rehydration include severe dehydration, severe and repeated vomiting, paralytic illness and abdominal distension, and glucose malabsorption. And the preferred IV solution is, as we have said, Ringer lactate, because the lactate will be changed to bicarbonate and replace the lost bicarbonate. Antimicrobial therapies administered to selected patients to shorten the clinical course and to decrease the excretion of pathogens and also to prevent complication. And also we should have to give antiprotozoal for patients with the other issue in the treatment of diarrhea is the treatment of dehydration in a malnourished patient. In malnourished patient, whenever possible, rehydration should be given pure. We should not give IV. And IV infusions are very dangerous and they are not recommended unless there is a shock or a loss of consciousness from a confirmed dehydration. Yeah, and the malnourished patients tend to develop electrolyte imbalance with a great excess of sodium and a deficit in potassium. And we should have to use a special ORS for a severely malnourished called rehydration solution for malnutrition or Rizomal. And a total of 100 ml of Rizomal per kg of body weight is usually enough to restore rehydration in those child, and we should have to give this 100 ml per kg of Rizomal over a 12-hour period. And for each water release, we should have to give 30 ml of Rizomal. And when we should have to weigh the child each hour and assess the liver size and also pulse rate, respiratory rate, and the other vital signs, because they are prone to overhydration and they might develop heart. If the child is in shock, if a malnourished child is in shock and if the child is unconscious, we should have to give Ringer lactate with 5% DW or half NS with 5% DW over 1 hour and reassess the child. And we should have to treat accordingly after that. As soon as the child regains consciousness, we should have to stop the drip and treat the child orally or by NG tube with 10 ml per kg of Rizoma. The other issues about persistent diarrhea. This is a diarrhea that occurs for more than 14 days and less than 10% of all diarrhea, but persistent diarrhea is associated with 30 to 50% of diarrheal days. There is no responsible for less than 10% of all diarrhea. And the malnutrition greatly increases the risk of death from persistent diarrhea. And the possible etiologies include secondary disaccharide deficiency, infectious causes such as Salmonella, Shigella, Enteroadherent E. coli, and Cryptosporidium. And contributing factors include protein energy malnutrition, micronutrient deficiency, and immunosuppression. And severe persistent diarrhea is those who have persistent diarrhea and those who are also dehydrated. So if a child is having persistent diarrhea and dehydrated at presentation, it is called severe persistent diarrhea. In this case, mortality is high and it needs nutritional rehabilitation and also rehydration, and also we should have to investigate for immune deficiency and resistant bacteria. Risk factors for persistent diarrhea include age of baby, less than 1 year, malnutrition, recent introduction of animal milk, and recent acute diarrhea. And also persistent diarrhea is a risk factor for having persistent diarrhea. When we see treatment of persistent diarrhea overall, we should have to correct dehydration if a child is dehydrated, and we should have to correct nutritional problems. We should have to reduce disaccharide and increase energy intake, and also supplement micronutrients. And we should have to give antibiotics for dysentery and avoid antibiotic for watery diarrhea, antimotility agents, and the diluted feeds. Overall, when we see prevention of diarrhea, hand washing is very important. Especially after using the toilet, after changing diaper, and before preparing food, and also breastfeeding a child, nutrition. We should have to prevent malnutrition because it predisposes for diarrhea, and also hygienic food preparation and the vaccination for rotavirus, measles is important. Thank you for your attention, and don't forget to subscribe this channel.